हाय हाय,
हेलो मैम, थैंक यू सो मच फॉर ज्वाइनिंग।
आई विल बी देयर फॉर शॉर्ट टाइम बिकॉज़ वी आर सेलिब्रेटिंग गर्ल चाइल्ड डे। वी
ओके मैम, थैंक यू सो मच।
हैविंग अ प्रोग्राम विद योर वॉलंटियर्स।
ओके
वी आर सी
या
अ लिटिल व्हाइल आई विल बी देयर।
ओके मैम, थैंक
स्टार्टिंग
यू।
लेट इज इट स्टार्टिंग लेट
No, no, we'll start, ma'am, in some time. Just waiting for some more people to join. Another 5 minutes will join. We'll start.
Okay.
You can turn it there.
No, this wire is still.
You have to be pushed to have food.
Good evening, madam.
Good evening. Good evening, sir.
No, no, that you can put it on, sir.
So, ma'am, Auda, how are you doing?
I'm doing fine. Your girls are here. We are celebrating Women's Girl Child Day.
Having okay, you're celebrating. Good.
Yeah. One
so,
day
in ma'am, the Juliana, nice to see you. I'm seeing you for the first time.
Oh, nice to see you too. Auda, hi. Nice to you.
Hi, Juliana.
Hi, Auda.
Nice to see you. I won't be long because I've got a program going.
Oh, okay, fine, yeah.
Till you start, I'll wait.
Okay, I'll be speaking later. Arun will be there.
Yeah.
Okay, nice, yeah.
See you.
Bye,
see you. All the best.
Bye, thank you, Avda.
Yeah, thank you too. I'll put off my mic.
I'll be speaking later. Arun will be there.
Yeah.
Okay. Nice. Yeah.
See you.
Bye.
See you. Best.
Bye. Thank you, Avda.
In another 2 minutes, we'll start, ma'am.
I'll put on my phone. I won't be there when you start.
I'll be speaking later. Arun will be there.
Yeah.
Okay. Nice. Yeah.
See you.
Bye,
see you. We'll start in another 2 minutes.
Bye, thank you, Avda.
In another 2 minutes, we'll start, ma'am. 90 people.
I'll put up my phone. I won't be there when we start.
Slowly.
I'll be speaking later. Arun will be there.
Yeah. Students.
Okay. Bye, see you.
We'll start in another 2 minutes.
Bye, thank you, Avda.
In another 2 minutes, we'll start, ma'am. 90 people.
I'll put up my phone. I won't be there when we start.
I'll be speaking later. Arun will be there.
Okay.
Bye.
We'll start in another 2 minutes.
Bye. Thank you, Avda.
In another 2 minutes, we'll start, ma'am. 90 people.
I'll put up my phone. I won't be there when we start.
I'll be speaking later. Arun will be there.
Yeah.
Okay.
I, Dr. Shruti Nadkarni, coordinator of Child Rights Cell, welcome you all, all the dignitaries who have joined us through YouTube link. I, Dr. Shruti Nadkarni, coordinator of Child Rights Cell, welcome you all, all the dignitaries who have joined us through YouTube link. I apologize for the connectivity issue here. I welcome you all again. It is said that it is very difficult to build a child. It is very easy to build a child, but it is difficult to repair a broken man. And that is why all the children who are dealing with this
for the connectivity issue,
all the people, stakeholders who are dealing with children need to know the social ills that children face and the remedies.
It is very difficult to build a child.
The Child Rights Cell, it is very easy to build a child, but tries to achieve to repair
by conducting various programs
and all the children.
Today's national webinar is on such issues.
All the people, stakeholders who are dealing with children need to
know this webinar. Social ills that children face and the remedies. World Child Day, which is celebrated on 24th of January throughout the country,
by conducting various.
And today we have two eminent personalities as a resource person, Sir Arulinda Pandey and Madam Yumna Lohar, who are going to talk to us about sex trafficking in Goa. To begin this webinar, I request Principal of our college and Faculty University of Law, and today we have two eminent personalities in resource question. So,
thank you, Dr. Shukran
I am a Very good afternoon, Mr. Supreme Chair. So to introduce, sir, he is a law graduate and has a postgraduate in criminology and correctional administration from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. He was as a senior researcher at OIS and was involved in a national study of human trafficking for many years from 1994 to 1997. He is a law graduate and one of the most founder member of criminology and correctional administration from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. An NGO working in Goa since 1997. Trafficking related to commercial sexual in a national tradition and for years from 1997. Our was awarded in the best NGO by Ministry of Home Affairs and Government of India in 2011 and Nari Shakti Award by Ministry of Home Affairs and Development Government of India in 2014 from the Economic Rehabilitation Office and Government of India set up by us. Our rehabilitation awarded the best NGO by Ministry of Home Affairs and Government of India. With this, I hand over to you, sir.
The incidence of rape will be increased. those women and girls who are exploiting many people, they are into this, which we want, so they are no commercial sexual lives. There are some beliefs of that many girls are into this because it is easy money. There are lots of money, some women and girls, there are some who are exploiting So this school of thought believes that these girls are being exploited by talking about the same group of girls visitors.
Now, this school of thought
believes this is a traditional family.
This is an organized family.
They don't see any social problems.
These girls
are being organized by talking about the same group of that the girls are not
only this school of thought believes
that and the girls is a traffic family.
This is an organized
of women getting it by unfair is on the girls themselves.
The school of thought is
because there are many girls who are orphans, who are unwed, who come from the family of women getting it by unfair, they don't get it.
Girls themselves.
Only you they get it. The owners of women who are orphans is on the girls.
Thank you.
70 years this year. It has provided our artificial prohibition of human traffic. In fact, this is a very progressive act. It also has a provision for those who are dedicating girls as Devadasi. But nationally, we have one special law called Immoral Trafficking Prevention Act. Now, this is a special law. I'll not get into detail of this law, but this law. Okay, its principal object is to prevent commercialization of prostitution and trafficking of women and girls in India. It provides that to take action against those who are involved in sale and purchase of person for commercial sexual exploitation. It provides for action against those who are benefiting from this business. Who are benefiting from this business? Brothel keepers, pimps, those who rent their place for commercial sexual activities, those who assist in conducting of this commercial sexual activity. It may be a taxi driver, it may be a pilot, it may be a hotel staff, whoever. The law not only provides for those who are not related to the girls involved in exploitation, but ITPA also involves if the family members are surviving on the earning of the girl. So the law is very clear that other than the girl, everyone who is involved in the business of commercial sexual activity or those who are benefiting from this or surviving from this are committing an offense and they need to be prosecuted. ITPA very clearly provides that we need to rescue the girl, we need to provide care and protection to the girl, and we need to rehabilitate the girl. It is unfortunate that though our law clearly provides and clearly distinguishes between a victim and a perpetrator, a victim and offender, but unfortunately, we continue to treat the victims of commercial sexual exploitation as offender. Now, we move to what is the situation of commercial sexual exploitation in Goa. The question arises, we have been working in Goa since last 22 years. Recently, we did a statistical analysis of the girls who have been rescued in Goa in last 5 years. Based on that research report, I'll be sharing certain findings, okay? But before that, let's understand, okay, why does the sex trafficking happen? We need to understand is that sex trafficking happens because there is a market for sexual services. There is a demand. There is a demand for sexual services. And who creates this demand? This demand is created by pimps, relatives, hotel, lodge owners, massage parlor owners, okay? Because they are benefiting from this business, not the girl. There is a misconception that the girls are into this because it is easy money, because they make a lot of money. It is the business people like the pimps, hotel owner, lodge owner, massage parlor owner, they are actually making money. You need to understand is that when the demand is created, the demand perpetuates supply. The supply means supply of commodity. Here the commodity is the girl. Then the girls are supplied. And this supply, at least in Goa we are finding, it is sometimes from Goa and then from other parts of India, which we will be discussing more in detail. You need to understand, okay, that this business, which is considered to be the second largest illegal revenue generating business in the world, generates a lot of business. And that is the reason we find that so many people are involved in this business. Okay. In fact, you can also say that this is a business where there is no investment in the work from the day one, you can make money. Okay. So now this is something, is the situation in Goa. There is a market in Goa because a lot of domestic tourists are coming. They are creating a demand, and this demand is being exploited by hotel owners, lodge owners, pimps, brothel keepers, and various other people. Okay, and here the victim is a commodity, and the victim is recruited either from Goa, okay, or they are supplied from other states of India or outside India. Again, most of these commodities, when I say victims, are those who fall in the category of most vulnerable girls. Okay, most vulnerable girls, again, as I was sharing in the beginning, are those who are orphan children, children of single parents, dysfunctional family, who are facing some or other problem. They are being exploited, recruited, and then being exploited in Goa. Okay. Now, when we talk about the situation is Goa, okay, what we have been seeing, and that what our study has shown, that Goa has developed as a market for prostitutes. The domestic tourists are coming here, creating demand, okay, and as a result, a market has developed. Goa has become a major destination state. Okay, destination state means that basically the girls are being trafficked from outside Goa. Okay, we are finding is that there are various new stores adding to Goa for supply of girls. We find that there is a trend which is changing when it comes to sex trafficking. The trend is more from offline to online. What when I say offline to online? Previously, okay, there used to be organized areas like Baina or Red Light area where the customers used to go looking for the girls. Okay. Then later we found that there were people, pimps, who used to roam around in the coastal area or near the bus stand or railway station and solicit customer for the girls, which we call offline. The more physical interaction was there, but increasingly we are finding in Goa, it is becoming online. Okay. The traffickers are very smart. They are using all possible technology to increase their business. You go on internet, you find that there are various sites, Escort, Call Girl. Okay. Through these sites, now they are soliciting the girls for soliciting customers for commercial sexual activity. We find that increasingly the commercial sexual activities locations in the Goa is spreading. It is not only now limited only to the coastal belt, but is also being spreading in the interior areas of Goa, which we will see through statistics. Okay. Now, now if we go to see the statistics, what our statistics shows, the statistics show that among 400 girls who were rescued, nearly 84% were Indian citizens, but 16%, which is quite high, were foreign nationals. Now, which are the countries they come from? Foreign nationals. We see a large number of them have been trafficked from Bangladesh, Uzbekistan, Nepal, Russia, Ireland, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan, Turkey. We need to understand a large number of girls from Bangladesh and Nepal have been trafficked. And most of the girls who have been trafficked from Bangladesh are those who have been trafficked without documents. We need to also see that when coming to the girls from Bangladesh and Nepal, their first destination has been in Mumbai. First, they have been exploited in Mumbai, and then they have been brought to Goa for exploitation. Whereas the girls from Central Asia, like Russia, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzstan, first they were trafficked to Delhi, and after being exploited there, then they were trafficked to Goa for commercial sexual exploitation. Then we come to other states in India from the girls where they traffic. I say the situation is very alarming. Okay, now we have total 29 states in India, and unfortunately, the statistic in Goa shows that the girls have been trafficked from 24 states of India. What does it say? It says that from 24 states, we have an organized network of supply of girls to Goa for commercial sexual activity. If you see statistics, Maharashtra, our neighboring state, is the main source state for India. Okay, followed by West Bengal, okay, then Delhi, and the fourth number is Goa. So what it shows that the girls from Goa have also been victims of commercial sexual exploitation. Okay, and it has to be, because if there is a market of commercial sexual activity, those who are involved in the business of commercial sexual exploitation, they will definitely recruit anyone who can provide money. Okay, the trafficker don't believe in religion, caste, race, okay, religion. Whomever they can recruit for commercial sexual exploitation and make money, they do. And as a result, we find that from Goa, 7.1% of the girls were victim of commercial sexual exploitation. I'd also like to clarify that the number 400 is of those who were rescued. This is not the number of the girls who were trafficked in Goa, okay, and were being commercially sexually exploited. Because that number nobody has.
I'd also like to clarify that the number 400.
Now, if you go to see, Goa commonly follows three forms, okay, of commercial sexual activity. The majorly which is done is hotel and lodge, followed with massage parlor, and then flat and bungalow. Here I like to emphasize that the form of flat and bungalow is increasing. And this is a very dangerous trend, because now what is happening is that hotel, lodge and massage parlor are usually located in public areas, whereas flat and bungalows are residential area. If these activities move towards flat and bungalow, which is going to be residential area, it is going to cause not only problem to the residents of the society, but also the other girls are going to become vulnerable. We have seen this trend in various metropolitan cities, whether it is Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, or Chennai, or Calcutta, wherein the red light areas are shrinking and the commercial sexual activities are moving towards residential area, and it is creating vulnerability to those people who are living in societies, different housing societies. So something needs to be done, and also moving of commercial sexual activity from public areas to residential area would further cause the difficulty or challenge for the law enforcement agency to take any action. When talking about which are the areas residential activity from public areas to residential area. Slide, you find that more or less everywhere the commercial sexual activities are happening. Though a large number of commercial sexual activities, okay, and again, this is the statistics which we are showing is based on the girls who have been rescued. Slide, here you find that most of the coastal belt, commercial sexual activity has happened and the police has rescued her. But what is also a dangerous thing which is showing that the commercial sexual activity is also moving towards area which are non-coastal. Bichulim, Vasco, Margaon, Konda. But we can understand in the coastal area there are tourists who are coming and creating a demand. But what is the reason that it is moving towards non-coastal area needs to be seen. Now, as I was saying, is that we are moving towards offline to online. This is going to be a big challenge. If we see other situation in other parts of India, there still the most of the form is of offline. But Goa, we are finding it is online. And it is going to throw a various kind of challenges before law enforcement agency. Like what? Now, what happens with online, being online, the reach of the pimp increases. Okay, the pimp doesn't have to stand at the bus stand or railway station or hotel and solicit the customer. Now, what happens with also the traffickers becomes faceless when in offline the trafficker is standing anywhere. Okay, and soliciting police can take action, but online makes the traffickers faceless. It is not only the trafficker. But what is also happening is that it is making easier for the client, okay, also to reach to the girls. Previously, clients, when they used to come from outside, they used to ask at the hotel, lodges, taxi driver and pilot. Okay, but now they don't have to do that. What they have to do is that they have to check internet. Wherein there's a number, they can call the number, certain verification are done by the PIMS, and after the verification is done, money is paid, the girl is supplied. So, and also what, here the clients are also becoming faceless. So the trafficker is becoming faceless, client is becoming faceless, and this is going to increase, okay. They increase the activity further because now this is less risk for the client as well as for the traffickers, okay, to be identified and prosecuted. I will like to end, okay, my presentation by saying is that we need, if we want to control sex trafficking, we need to protect victims. What is important is that we need to do distinction between those who are victims and those who are exploiting. Okay, and also what we need to do is that those who are creating demand, we need to act against them. We need to protect victim and we need to act against those who are creating demand. It is only then we will be able to control sex trafficking in Goa. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to respond at the end of the presentation. We need to protect victim and we need to act against those who are creating demand.
Thank you very much, sir.
We will be able.
The questions, the participants, you may put up your questions in the chat box and we will take up the questions immediately after the second resource person finishes his presentation. Thank you very much. I would request the question, Professor Pawan Kalwale, to introduce our second resource person to the gathering. Take up the questions immediately after Professor Pawan resource person.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much. At the outset, let me congratulate Arsh Anyay Rahit Zindagi for doing an excellent job and making this society a better place to live in. Thank you so very much. Now it's my pleasure to introduce our next guest speaker. Ms. Yeah. Juliana Lohar. Ma'am has done her master's in social work from Mumbai University in 2002. Ms. Juliana Lohar is the coordinator of ARSH, that is Anyay Rahit Zindagi, a development organization working in Goa since 1997, which works specifically for human trafficking for commercial sexual exploitation. Again, commercial sexual exploitation. It is a nodal NGO for integrated anti-human trafficking unit of Goa Police. Ma'am has also done a lot of research since 2002 till date. I would rather like to highlight a few. Ma'am has done research in rehabilitation process of rescued girls in Nepal in 2002, phenomena of commercial sexual exploitation in Goa, India in 2007, causing of trafficking for commercial sexual exploitation in West Bengal, and services required for combating trafficking in 2007, phenomena of child labor Baina, Bosco, Goa, India in 2008, understanding nature, pattern and factors of sexual abuse among adults and boys in Baina, red light area, Goa, India in 2011, psychosocial and emotional care provided to children in hostels in Maharashtra, India in 2012, and completed research on child sexual abuse in Bosco, Goa in 2016. Quite a few to highlight. Ma'am has also co-authored a handbook, Caregivers on Handling Child Sexual Abuse, and a training module for reducing harm, a training manual on building skills in service providers for service providers working with victims of sexual abuse. Ma'am has also drafted a rehabilitation scheme for the victims of sexual violence for Goa government in year 2011. Ma'am participated in the draft of Goa children abuse. She's been working closely for the victims of sexual violence for Goa government in year 2011. She's been very organized a rehabilitation program of ARSH for rehabilitation of survivors of sexual violence and exploitation. Ma'am is closely has been closely working with the victims of sexual violence in their recovery from trauma and their therapeutic counseling. Ma'am has conducted several workshops for all the stakeholders which are related and which help the sexual victims, right from the police to the children to the committee members. All sort of training she provides, and she's been providing the training for a lot of states like West Bengal, Nagaland, Sikkim, Manipur, Mizoram, Guwahati, Karnataka, and Maharashtra. Ma'am is a member of Sexual Harassment Committee formulated under the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act 2013. Everyone might be aware of it. And she is also a member of various schools, colleges, companies, government departments and NGOs. Ma'am is an active member for the school committee, school management committees under Right to Education Act. She is a member of Prabhat Committee, Goa Government, a scheme for victims of social violence, and Vendors Association Committee under Marmugao Municipality Anti-Tobacco Committee. Ma'am has a very wide experience, as I have read this TV for you all, and it would have not been an appropriate person to talk on this topic. So rather, I would like to welcome Ms. Juliana Lohar, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pawan, for that introduction. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, great. Now, Mr. Arun Pandey, in the first half, has given a very good perspective with regard to sex trafficking and the situation in Goa. What I would be doing is mine is going to be a little bit of interactive, and we're going to see the phenomena and understand the phenomena and see our role through, through a case study that I would be showing to you now. Okay, screen is visible to all. Hello, is the PPT visible? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so once I show, because after I show the case study, the case study is in two halves. So I'll do the first half and then I'll need responses from you all. Move to the second half, responses. we'll have a sort of discussion. And then after that, I would conclude by talking about interventions that's required for victims of sex trafficking. Okay? All right. So we look at this case study where we have Rasina Sheikh. Okay? She's a 19-year-old girl. She's a resident of Murshidabad, West Bengal. She was married at the age of 16 years to a person who was 15 years older than her. All right. Her father was a hand rickshaw puller and mother a housewife. She had six siblings. After 3 years of her marriage, her husband, who was a construction worker, brought her to Bangalore. In Bangalore, she stayed in a slum area. Next to her house was a widow named Anjali. She suggested to Rasina, Anjali suggested to Rasina to go to Goa to work in a casino. Rasina, who wanted to support her parents, agreed to her offer. She shared with her husband of her interest of going to Goa to work in a casino. Her husband refused permission. One day, without informing him, Rasina, along with Anjali, came to Goa. Agreed to her offer. Okay? She shared with her husband of her interest of going to Goa. So, can I move to the next slide?
Yes.
Can somebody unmute themselves and let me know?
It would be Anjali in this case.
Yes. Yes.
It would be Anjali in this case.
Unmute themselves. Okay, Anjali, what offense has she created?
It would be Anjali in this case. Probably she has enticed the person for a better prospect. It would be Anjali.
That's an offense. Unmute themselves. Okay, Anjali, what offense has she created? Okay, thank you so much. What's your name?
Yes. The person Francis. For a better
thank you, Francis. For being so courageous to respond. I hope you're from the same college, right? Okay,
I'm
hope.
From Kare.
Okay, Kare. Okay, so Francis is the courageous boy from Kare who has responded. Anyone else? Courageous to respond.
I hope you're. So I think the part. Anushree has typed something, ma'am.
Yes, can you please let me know what's the response? Yeah. Okay, so Francis is the courageous boy from Kare. Shruti, can you let me know the response because I can't see the type thing because I'm doing the screen.
Yes, ma'am.
So what is
Anushree is saying it's Raina's father because she was married under age of 16.
Okay, so one is Raina's father, okay?
Yes, Rasina's father.
Sorry, Rasina's father. So sorry, Rasina's father, yeah?
Then Kajol is saying Anjali.
Okay.
Zinaida is saying Anjali and Francis is saying Anjali.
But why Anjali? Come on, law students, give me the reason. What is the offense Anjali has created? Francis was courageous to speak up.
Zinaida is saying Anjali and Francis is saying Anjali.
But why Anjali? I don't know. I mean, I'm not very sure, but let me. It's just that, you know, she's giving her. I don't know. I mean, I'm not very sure, but let me. Probably a better means of living without even knowing what she's getting into, or, you know.
But work.
Anjali is aware of what, you know, how the life is in a casino and then.
Okay, Francis, you know Anjali. Francis? Francis, you're saying Anjali, is giving all this offer. Right of now, can you see where Anjali is? How does Anjali know about the casino?
She suggested Rasina to go to Goa to work.
So suggesting is an offense, law students.
No, ma'am.
Okay, there's a girl and then a boy. Shruti, if you can help me, who can speak first?
Yes. Anushree, let Anushree speak first, then Neville will take. Anushree, what do you have to say?
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes.
Ma'am, actually what I wanted to say is Anjali is Rasina is under an influence by Anjali who is giving her hopes of better work. She doesn't really know the conditions and what might come to her if she takes steps according to what Anjali is telling us. There could be undue influence because Rasina here is is a troubled person, and this girl, this lady Anjali, is trying to open some hope up for her.
So opening hope and giving a dream, is that an offense?
Not exactly, but what I meant to say is seeing her situation, seeing her situation at a particular time, so life must be hard for her.
Okay. So she's helping her, no?
No.
So she's helping her. Rasida's life is so hard.
At the same time, what is the work that she's going to do in a casino is the next question.
Right. Now that we will see in the next slide. But as of now, looking at this situation now,
Neville Costa
had
to say something.
Yes, Neville.
In fact, yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Yes. Ma'am, see, in this case, I mean, just going by this one slide, I wouldn't jump to conclusions because, see, Rasina is basically 19 now. Right. And nowhere in that slide has it mentioned that she's having any issues or anything. It says for better prospects. In fact, the question about flash trade hasn't even, you know, been highlighted anywhere in the slide.
So you're speaking like a real lawyer. Okay.
Yeah, so this widow, ma'am, this widow might have been a motherly figure, whoever to Anjali, I mean, to Rasina. Anjali might have been a motherly figure.
Right.
And she, with all goodwill or with all good intentions, she just told her about a casino for better prospects as related to a job. That's it.
Right. Okay. So now,
Now, no offense is committed. Okay.
Okay. Excellent. Yeah. So which year are you? Mevin, right?
Neville Costa, ma'am. Yeah, I'm in the first year.
Okay. Oh, Mevin, in the first year already you have observed certain things. So, Shruti, I'll move ahead. Okay. And then we'll have discussion further if anybody wants to
speak. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, as you all have said, and as Mevin, your classmate, has highlighted, that if you look at it right of now, looking at the situation, my question was, what is the offense? Okay. And who has committed the offense? Okay. So if you look at it, somebody did rightly mention that she, the offense is her child marriage here, right? Because she's been married at the age of 16. And somebody said her parents, her husband, as we see in this slide, okay, is who has committed the offense of child marriage. Maybe the offense, the others who have participated in this marriage have also committed an offense, but right of now, they are not in this situation, in this case study as of now. So if you look at it here, the offense that we look is the offense of child marriage. The act that is applicable is the Prohibition of Child Marriage Act 2006. Now let's move further, okay? And now, I hope you will look as lawyers and see now in this situation, again, the question is the same. Y'all can note down who has committed the offense and what is the offense that is committed. Someone said, let's see what happens, what Anjali does to her in Goa. Okay, so in Goa, what happens is Suleiman, who's known to Anjali, he comes to receive both of them at Margao bus stand. From Margao bus stand, they were taken to a flat to stay. At the flat, she was told that she will have to prostitute. Rasina was shocked and she refused. When she refused, she was threatened. Rasina was very scared and she followed all the instructions of Suleiman. Suleiman used to get calls from the customers and then send Rasina along with Anjali to the hotels and flats. For the purpose of transportation, they had hired a car. The driver of the car was Raju and the owner was Thomas. Rasina's phone was taken away by Suleiman and she was given a new phone with local SIM. She was allowed to call her husband under supervision of Anjali or Suleiman. She had told her husband that she was working in casino and will be returning soon. One day, when Rasina had gone to one of the flats in a housing society, the people of the housing society came to know that she was in prostitution. The men and women from the society got together and physically assaulted her. They beat her terribly. They tore her clothes and cut her hair. After the incident, Rasina got very scared. She requested Suleiman to let her be free. But she was not allowed to return to Bangalore and was forced to entertain customers. After nearly 3 months, the police rescued Rasina. Okay, so I'll put the slide back again. Those who want to write, type the response, you can type, and the others who want to speak can speak. What are the other offenses that is here and who has committed it? Okay, so I'll put the slide back again. Those who want to write, type the response, you can type, and the others who want to speak can speak. What are the other offenses that is here and who has committed it? Okay, so I'll put the slide back again. Those who want to write, type the response, you can type, and the others who want to speak can speak. What are the other offenses that is here and who has committed it?
So some people are suggesting Suleiman and Anjali.
Okay. Suleiman. So you're saying the over here who has committed the offense is Suleiman, Anjali. Yes.
So some people are suggesting Suleiman and Anjali.
Who else? And what is the offense they have committed?
Suleiman. So you're saying the over here.
Suleiman has threatened.
Suleiman.
Okay.
Anjali.
Okay. And
yes.
So some people are suggesting. Then
who else?
Yeah.
And what is the offense?
Vanchika Braganza is saying even other people who assaulted Rasina, they have committed offense. So then there is another view saying Suleiman, as he threatened Rasina after she refused.
Vanchika Braganza,
the people who beat Anjali, they committed. People for taking law in their hands. Then for assaulting her. Suleiman for threatening to prostitution. Suleiman and Anjali. Exploitation by Suleiman. Many are saying Suleiman.
Okay. Anyone wants to speak and give their opinion and their view?
Suleiman and Anjali.
Raju and Thomas, if they are aware about the activity.
Okay. Sorry? Yeah.
Raju and Thomas, if they were aware about the activity.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, sorry. Yes, Shruti, somebody speaking? Somebody wants to give their opinion or do I move ahead?
Okay. Yes, someone wants to say something?
Okay.
Yes, Neville?
Now, Neville, speak.
Yeah, ma'am, I've typed in the comment. Basically, if Raju and Thomas were also aware, then they also party to it. That's what I wanted to add, ma'am.
Okay, good. But do you think Raju and Thomas would be aware?
Neville, speak.
It depends, you know, because if this has been done on a regular basis and they are basically, you know, with Suleiman, then I feel they can be aware because, you know, they are basically transporting her regularly.
Right.
So it is possible. It is possible that the victim has also opened up to them. There's a huge possibility.
Right. Right. Thank you, Mevin. Yes. Anyone else? Okay.
So if you look at for abetting.
Okay. Yes.
For abetting. Abetment.
Okay. Abetment too. Anyone else? Okay.
Okay.
So if you look at anyone else is speaking, or I'll just move ahead.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, I'll move ahead because I think I have less time also. So if you look at it here, as you all have said, the offenses, you all have rightly pointed out most of the names of who have committed the offenses. And as you all have said, these are the various persons who have committed the offenses, right? Anjali, nobody mentioned about Anjali now. Did Anjali commit any offense?
Yes, ma'am.
And, yes, from before only. Somebody was forecasting Anjali in the first slide, but second slide you forgot to mention Anjali, right? So if you look at it, these are the various persons who have committed the offenses. Now, these are the various offenses that they have committed. Okay? Somebody has spoken about procure. If you look at it, they have procured her. Anjali has, you know, deceived her and brought her here. Okay, and then Suleiman, they together have basically put her into commercial sexual exploitation. Okay, you also look at it in the case study, they are earning from her, right? Suleiman, Anjali, they are getting an earning from her and they're living on her earning basically. detaining a person. Suleiman has taken away the phone from her. Okay, he's not allowing her to contact. Okay, her own possession he has taken away. He's keeping her confined. He is always ensuring that she's in presence of someone. Okay? Allowing premises to be used as a brothel. So wherever they are going for the commercial sexual activity, okay, those premises that are being used is as brothels. Okay, recruiting, transport, harbour, transport to receive. As you all know, IPC 370 talks about all of these forms. Okay, and you all said is the people in the people in the locality, other people, which you all spoke about the society people. Okay, they have outraged her modesty. Okay. They have molested her, right? So if you look at it, these are the various offenses that have been committed by each of these persons. And the law that you look at it, which act you can look at, is obviously Immoral Trafficking Prevention Act, covers most of this, especially when she has been taken by Suleiman and Anjali for commercial sexual activity. And then you have the various sections of IPC for these persons, okay, let it be the society people, okay, for outraging her modesty, for molesting her, for assaulting her, okay. And also Raju and Thomas, as you have said, is they are helping in her transportation. Okay, so if you look at it, these are the various sections, these are the various acts that are applicable to each of these characters who have somewhere, they are helping in a basically got this girl into Rasina into commercial sexual activity. Now if you look at it now, what are the interventions and services that is required, okay, or that could have been done or that can be done? So if you look at it for Rasina, what becomes important is she was married as a young girl. Okay, when she was married as a young girl, maybe she would have dropped out of, she had to give up her schooling, so she had no, she has no skills, right, no vocational training. So if Rasina as a young girl was provided with vocational training, with life skills, with a bit of, you know, this thing, coping mechanism in her to handle certain situations, maybe she would have not been deceived by Anjali and landed up in the situation. Okay, Rasina's parents, had they known about the Child Marriage Act and the offense that they are creating, maybe they would have not got her married to this man who was 15 years older to her and got her away from her house so far away to Bangalore with him, right? So if you look at it, if some work had to be done with her parents and with Rasina, maybe they could have prevented Rasina from landing up into this situation, from being a victim of sex trafficking. The other intervention and services that becomes important is, once Rasina was trafficked and sold into commercial sexual activity, you need to see how these are the key players who have somewhere impacted and caused further harm in her life, right? So if the tourism industry players, they do sometimes, as we know, when we talk about the situation of Goa, okay, as Arun has pointed, there is a demand, okay, supply is required, and if we somewhere keep on adding to the demand, okay, it's not only the girls who are coming from out, even our girls living in Goa becomes very, very vulnerable. So I think intervention and services, what becomes important is with the tourism industry, the hotels and vehicle persons, letting them know the legal provision and also seeing how they do not add on to this illegal activity of ensuring that commercial sexual activity continues in the continues in Goa. What also becomes important is when we talk about handling sex trafficking, the people in the community and society people, they become very important. They cannot, as one of you rightly pointed out, they cannot take the law in their hand. You have the law enforcement agencies, right? So they need to report it to them and to see how necessary action is taken. In fact, we have the Integrated Anti-Human Trafficking Unit, which is there north and south. So approaching them and seeing how they take up the issue, instead of they themselves taking the law in their hand. And if you look at it, when you talk about sex trafficking in Goa, obviously it is all of us together. Let it be NGOs, let it be police, let it be the community people, all of us together, persons from tourism industry, together, how do we protect young girls? How do we ensure that Goa doesn't become a further hub and an organized place for sex trafficking? As you have seen in the study itself has shown that how Goa is a place which is quite high for sex trafficking, and now it is getting more organized, and the if you look at it also, it's more organized, and also the whole form, the method that is happening, right? So I think it's important that all of us together, if we work together, then we can see how Goa doesn't develop further into sex, a place for further into sex trafficking. I think it's also important to work on the reform of offenders. If Anjali, if there is a scope of working with her, okay, Suleiman, if he's not too much into the business, Raju, can we work with them to see how they get out of this organized crime and take up some alternatives so that they don't further somewhere further add on into further exploitation of girls and women. So these are some of the interventions that in this case study that could have been done. Okay, now if you look at it, I was asked also to share about ARS's intervention. Yes, ARS, we our focus is work, our focus of work is on sexual violence. We believe it's important to share information. So, and as you as in the introduction, it was told, it was shared that we are the nodal agency that is appointed, okay, by the Goa police to work on human trafficking issues. Okay, so what we have been doing is when we have been accompanying the police for rescue, okay, and then working with the victims post rescue when they are at the government state protective home, okay, and then providing them the rehabilitation services and whatever services they require at the state protective home, and also seeing is that what information is there that is received at the time of rescue. We go back to the source states to share information using various techniques, okay, through discussions, through street plays, to let them know what is the situation and how we can prevent the girls from being trafficked for commercial sexual exploitation. So that's something that we do, is working towards prevention. Then we work towards seeing that how if a girl is rescued, okay, how she is provided with proper rehabilitation services. So we work with the Women and Child Welfare Department closely at the state protective home, providing them rehabilitation services, which includes counseling, which includes psychosocial services, and also seeing is those girls who are foreign nationals, how they are repatriated back to their country. So we work closely with the embassy and the high commissions to see how girls are repatriated back to their country. Based on the need and the request of the girls, we conduct various vocational training with an agency which basically provides the, you know, with a renowned agency that provides them with a certificate, so that once they are out of the shelter home, they do get a certificate in their hand and they can get employment. And apart from that, we have Swift Wash Laundry, as already shared, that is an economic alternative which is set up in the industrial area here in Sankol industrial area, which basically provides those living in Goa with an economic alternative so that they are able to earn money. Apart from that, as we have shared, is we believe in working with the various service providers to see how, one, there is prevention, secondly, to see if girls are trafficked, okay, how they are rescued, how the rescue is done in a sensitive manner, and then how they are handled. Because as per Immoral Trafficking Prevention Act, the girls once rescued are produced before the SDM, and then they are kept at the state protective home before the final order and decision is taken for the rehabilitation. So we do provide a lot of training to various stakeholders. So let it be the police, let it be Women and Child Welfare Department, to see how victims are handled in a sensitive manner so that they are recovered from the trauma and abuse that they go through. So this is basically what ARS has been doing, the various intervention that ARS has been providing to work on the issue of sex trafficking here in the state of Goa. Okay. So I'll end here with, if you'll have any questions, you'll can. The floor is open for questions now. The questions will be answered either by Arun or by me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Yes, participants, anybody has any questions to both the resource persons, you may post them in the chat box, or you may unmute yourself and ask.
The questions will be answered either by Arun or by me.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Yes, participants, anybody has any questions to both the resource persons, you may post them in the chat box, or you may unmute yourself and ask. So by the time the questions come in, I would like to ask something about these victims, because what happens is, as regards these girls who are trafficked, they are considered as victims, but they are also considered as, there is always a conflict whether they should be considered as victims or whether they should be considered as part of the like offender. Because we hear of stories like nowadays that not all are victims. Some of them, they willingly also participate in this trade. So there's always a conflict whenever we also teach this part to the students. The question is always asked, why always they are considered as victims? They could be offenders themselves also. So what do you have to say about this?
See, see, let's talk about the law. Okay. Law is very clear, is that if a girl sells her body for commercial purpose, it is not an offense. As per the law, it is only those who are involved in sale and purchase, or those who are benefiting from by selling the girl, are committing an offense.
Law is very clear.
So that is one part. Okay. Now, what is what we need to also understand is that many a times we see the girl, okay, we meet the girl, and based on the girl's behavior, we decide that the girl is a victim or not. We also, when we are involved in rescue, and many times we rescue the girl is very hostile, okay, saying that, aap kyun mere ko rescue karta hai? मेरा मेरे को खाना देगा क्या? मेरा शादी करेगा क्या? Okay, the hostility is there. We need to understand is that the behavior of the girl, the response of the girl to the initiative taken by the state or NGO depends on how long she has been in commercial sexual exploitation. Our experiences has been that there are three stages. First stage is the resistance stage, when a girl is inducted in commercial sexual activity. That is the time when she asks for help. Okay, most of the time she doesn't receive help. And this is the time the most of the crime is committed against her. We find we have known that illegal confinement, gang rape, okay, locked for days, not given food till and until she breaks and she agrees to whatever the trafficker wants them to do. After resistance stage comes the adaptation stage. Adaptation stage is the stage wherein whatever the traffickers want the girls to do, she does it. And the last stage is the acceptance stage. If we rescue the girl in the resistance stage or the stage when she does whatever the traffickers are saying, she will be more participatory. She will be thankful to those who are helping her in her rescue. But if you are rescuing her in the later stage, acceptance stage, when she has accepted the exploitation, she knows that there is no way out. There is hardly any alternative. Okay, you will be surprised to know that in whole of India, other than Swift Wash, there is hardly any livelihood alternative for traffic victims. Okay, so in this situation, they usually found to be very hostile. But leave this aside. The law is very clear. The law is clear that if anybody is involved in sale and purchase of the girl or benefiting from her earning, the girl becomes victim, and those who are involved in making money are committing an offense. They usually found to be very hostile. But
so there is another question here. Do these victims always come from low income background?
See, not necessarily. The reason for a person to be into commercial sexual activity is not only poverty. Okay, as I said initially, there are reasons that many victims are victim of child sexual abuse. There are other also reason, okay, the psychological problems are there. dysfunctional family is there. Victim of domestic violence are there. So there are various factors which causes a person vulnerability to commercial sexual exploitation. We have also come across, because largely when we say that, there are few girls who we have rescued have been into films. Okay. But again, when we probed further, we found that somewhere their emotional exploitation has led them, okay, into this. To commercial sexual exploitation. We have also come across, because largely when we say that.
So Anushree Desai also says that in case the trafficked person consents, are they still considered victims?
See, the section 370 of IPC is very clear. Is that consent is immaterial when it comes to trafficking. Okay. Whether the person is victim or adult.
So Anushree Desai also.
So law very clearly says, as I'm saying, section 370, a person who is being sold and purchased by somebody else, whether with consent or without consent, whether minor or major, okay, the person would be called, who's being sold will be a victim, and those who are involved in sale and purchase are offenders. So if a girl herself says that I want to, I'm ready to, I want to sell myself for commercial sexual activity, a person who is bringing her to Goa and then selling her is committing an offense, and the girl is not committing an offense. So if a girl herself says that I want.
So there's another question. Respected sir, madam, I am not in favor of prostitution. Abolishing such prostitution act will make the hungry man to rape the ordinary women. How do we overcome such situation if such risk is imposed?
This is generally said, okay, that if the prostitution is not there, okay, there will be increase in rape, but no scientific study has been done. Okay, to establish that. See the case of Goa. Baina has closed, okay, but has sexual violence increased in Vasco? Has sexual violence increased in Goa? Okay. So that is one part. The second part is that, are we saying is that we need to have one set of women, okay, who should be serving the sexual need of men so that other set of women get saved? Are we talking about that? Are we saying that in our society there should be two set of men, two set of women, one to serve the sexual need of men and other good women? We need to understand is that this is patriarchal thinking which has been pushed in. Okay. So what is important is that those who are going to commit sexual violence, okay, will anyway continue to conduct, even they are even the women in prostitution is there or not. And you will be surprised to know that a large population of clientele who visit these girls are married men. Not necessarily other first time they are exploring sexual.
So there's another question which I would like to ask. How do we means, are there any traits of these perpetrators? How do we tell the girls to be cautious about them? Because we hear many cases where they have been lured by these perpetrators. So any traits of that, what advice you would give them?
See, recently we have found, because it is especially now online is used to lure, okay, and recruit girls. Now what we are finding is that a large number of traffickers, okay, they are checking the Facebook accounts of girls, okay, and many times the girls are uploading their personal and private messages. I am feeling low, I had a breakdown, I separated from my boyfriend, etc. And also providing personal details like phone number and other things. In many cases, we have found that the traffickers, they have made fake Facebook accounts, and through that, they send other friends requests, okay, and then build relationship, and then they have been involved, you know, in the, somewhere asking them to leave house, come out, and then, you know, force them into prostitution. We find a large number of such cases, especially with adolescent girls. They send other so we need to be careful what kind of information we are putting in social media. Juliana, you want to add?
I'll just add. Okay, I think the few this thing that we need to see of these perpetrators are obviously one, they are using social media. So we need to see few traits that we need to keep in mind. Okay, and able to identify, is this person going to cause harm to me? Is see, are they too emotional? कि तेरे बिना मेरा लाइफ ही नहीं चल पाएगा, मैं अपने आप को मार डाल दूंगी, ठीक है? So if the emotional level is too high and in a short period of time, then that is one sign that we need to be careful. I mean, that's a sign of danger for us if we are in contact with such a person. The other thing that we need to see about these perpetrators, these traffickers, are they are very secretive about themselves. The information, the secretive about themselves is that यार तू कौन सा गांव से है यार मैं तो उधर से हूँ किधर से नहीं बताते हैं so the personal information is very very secretive okay वो गांव का नाम गलत देंगे शायद recently I've known of a case where this person says he's from Goa he's a Goan on Facebook it was he's a Goan he's given a Goan name everything and when the girl was rescued we came to know he's from West Bengal okay so what you need to do is few signs is check the emotional level and see the secretiveness that the person is having about himself these are two signs that we need to be a little alert on
Facebook it was he's a Goan he's given a Goan name everything and when the girl was rescued we came to know
any other questions from any participant
what you need to do is few signs is check the emotional level and see the secretness
yes any other queries
that the person is having about himself
these are there's a question Arun with regard to male are there any cases of sex trafficking of the male gender which has raised alarms
any other questions
we haven't come across other that boys being trafficked from outside but we had cases okay wherein and a boys have been sexually abused commercially sexually exploited so we had come across such incidents okay but again let me tell you is that we don't know what is the how much is the problem because no empirical study has been done sexually
abused and with regard to boys they have been but it is not organized it's not an organized crime so there have been few cases of where boys have been used for sexual purposes but it is not an organized crime
what is other the how much is the problem
any other question
empirical study has been done
and with regard to boys they have been but it is not organized it's not an organized crime so there have been few cases of where boys have
if there are no other question we can proceed ahead before we close down on this program today I would like to inform all the participants that the link for feedback form has been posted on the in the chat box kindly fill in the feedback form to receive your e-certificate and also I have been told that sometimes certificate goes in spam folder so please bear with that and check if you are not received it in your inbox kindly check in your spam folder as well so the link for feedback form is already posted all the participants kindly please fill in the feedback form to receive your certificate sometimes we were indeed fortunate today to have ma'am Juliana and sir Arun Pandey for to speak to us on a very important topic and that was I think most appropriate topic on this National Girl Child Day celebration and ma'am and sir we are indeed very thankful for sharing your experience and to formally thank our resource persons, I would like to request the IQAC coordinator of our college. Ma'am, Gauriti Simois, Dr. Gauriti Simois, to propose vote of thanks. Gauriti, over to you.
Thank you very much, Ruthie. Thank you very much, Shruti, and good evening to all. Am I audible? So, it's a formal vote of thanks at the end of a very fruitful webinar. So, on behalf of Govind Ramnath Parekh College of Law, the Child Rights Cell, and Internal Quality Assurance Cell of our college, I express my deepest gratitude, first and foremost, to our MOU partners, Modern College, for associating with us and helping us in the effective organization of today's national webinar on sex trafficking of girls in Goa, issues and concerns. I hope the association goes a long way. I'm also indebted to our knowledgeable resource person, Mr. Arunandra Pandey, Director, ERS. Sir, it is not the first time that we have heard you speak on this forum, and I'm sure that it won't be the last. Thank you for highlighting the plight of girls involved in sex trade in the state of Goa, and for sharing your valuable inputs on this forum. Wishing you all the best in all the future endeavors. Thank you.
Thank you.
My gratitude also goes out to Ms. Juliana Lohar, coordinator of ERS. It was nice, ma'am, having you amongst our midst today, and I'm sure the problems that you have highlighted could effectively be minimized, if not fully ended. Thank you for the fruitful session we had with our students today. I'm also indebted to Mr. Pavan Kalwale, Assistant Professor of Modern Law College, for his association throughout the webinar. Thank you, Mr. Pavan, for your association. I'm also grateful to our principal, Dr. Saba da Silva, for encouraging us always in all the endeavors that we have taken by various cells, clubs, committee of the institution. He has always led from the front and paved way for many such initiatives. Thank you very much, sir. The Child Rights Cell, headed by Dr. Shruti Natkarni, Mr. Saprem Shirvaikar, and Ms. Niharika Chari, have also done a commendable job, especially in ensuring that days such as the National Girl Child Day is commemorated. And today's webinar was just a glaring example. Congratulations to the entire team of the Child Rights Cell for effective implementation and smooth implementation and organization. Last but not the least, I'm also grateful to our students who have always been our permanent audience, as well as the faculties of both the institutions, Modern Law College Pune and Govind Ramnath Parekh College of Law Margaon, for your esteemed presence through this virtual platform. Thank you, one and all, and have a lovely weekend. Thank you.
Who have always been our permanent audience, as well as the faculties of. Thank you very much, sir and ma'am, for this sharing of your information with us. Sir, thank you very much. You always been kind enough to always oblige us with your kind words. So thank you so much for your presence today. And also,
thank
ma'am,
you very much for inviting us. Thank you so much, Shruti ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you. Bye.
Sir, thank you very much. You always been kind enough to always, sir, we'll surely be in touch with you, and we will like to be associated with you even for our future programs. Your
presence today. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you for inviting us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, participants, and you all please fill in the feedback form and you can leave the meet. Sir, we'll surely be in touch with you, and we will like to be associated with you even for our future programs.
Okay, thank you so much.
For inviting us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, participants, and you all please fill in the feedback form and you can leave the meet. Sir, we'll surely be in touch with you, and we will like to be associated with you even for our future programs.
Okay, thank you so much.